Section 1 of The Art of Worldly Wisdom. Art of Worldly Wisdom by Baltasar Gracián. Translated by Joseph Jacobs. Section 1. To Mrs. G. H. Lewis. Dear Mrs. Lewis, this little book were not worthy of being associated with your name, did it not offer an ideal of life at once refined and practical, cultured yet wisely energetic. Gracián points to noble aims and proposes, on the whole, no ignoble means of attaining to them. The Spanish Jesuit sees clear, but he looks upward. There is, however, one side of life to which he is entirely blind, as was perhaps natural in an ecclesiastic writing before the age of salons. He nowhere makes mention in his pages of the gracious influence of woman as inspirer and consoler in the battle of life. Permit me to repair this omission by placing your name in the forefront of this English version of his maxims. To those honored with your friendship, this will by itself suffice to recall all the ennobling associations connected with your sex. Believe me, dear Mrs. Lewis, your most sincerely, Joseph Jacobs. Kilburn, 26th of October, 1892. Preface. My attention was first drawn to the Oraculo Manual by Mr. now Sir Mountstuart Grant Duff's admirable article on Baltasar Gracián in the Fortnightly Review of March, 1877. I soon after obtained a copy of Schopenhauer's excellent version, and during a journey in Spain I procured with some difficulty a villainously printed edition of Gracián's work, Barcelona, 1734, Por Joseph Giralt, which contains the Oraculo Manual towards the end of the first volume, pages 431 to 494. I have translated from this last, referring in the many doubtful places of its text to the first Madrid edition of 1653, the earliest in the British Museum. I have throughout had Schopenhauer's version by my side, and have found it, as Sir Mountstuart Grant Duff says, a most finished piece of work, though I have pointed out in the notes a few cases where he has failed, in my opinion, to give Gracián's meaning completely or correctly. I have little doubt that I am a fellow sinner in this regard. I know no prose style that offers such difficulty to a translator as Gracián's laconic and artificial epigrams. It is not without reason that he has been called the introducible. The two earlier English versions miss his points time after time, and I found it useless to refer to them. On the other hand, I have ventured to adopt some of Sir Mountstuart Grant Duff's often very happy renderings in the extracts contained in his fortnightly article. I have endeavoured to reproduce Gracián's laconism and cultismo in my version, and have even tried to retain his many paronomasias and jingles of similar sound. I may have here and there introduced others of my own to redress the balance for cases where I found it impossible to produce the same effect in English. In such cases I generally give the original in the notes. Wherever possible, I have replaced Spanish proverbs and proverbial phrases by English ones, and have throughout tried to preserve the characteristic rhythm and brevity of the proverb. In short, if I may venture to say so, I have approached my task rather in the spirit of Fitzgerald than of Bourne. The gem on the title, representing a votive offering to Hermes, the god of worldly wisdom, is from a fine paste in the British Museum of the best period of Greek glyptic art. I have to thank Mr. Cecil Smith of that institution for kind advice in the selection. Let me conclude these prefatory words with a piece of advice as oracular as my original. When reading this little book for the first time, read only 50 maxims and then stop for the day. Joseph Jacobs. Testimonia. Il est si concis, si rompu et si étrangement coupé qu'il semble qu'il ait pris l'obscurité à tâche. Aussi le lecteur a besoin d'en deviner le sens, et souvent, quand il a compris, il trouve qu'il s'est étudié à faire une énigme d'une chose fort commune. F. van Aarsens, Voyage d'Espagne, 1667, page 294. Il a beaucoup d'élévation, de subtilité, de force, et même de bon sens. Mais on ne sait le plus souvent ce qu'il veut dire, et il ne le sait pas peut-être lui-même. quelques-uns de ses ouvrages ne semblent être faits que pour n'être point entendus. Bourhours, Entretien d'artiste et de gêne, 1671, page 203. Luisa de Padilla, a lady of great learning and countess of Aranda, was in like manner angry with the famous Gracian upon his publishing his treatise of the Discreto, wherein she fancied that he had laid open those maxims to common readers which ought only to be reserved for the knowledge of the great. These objections are thought by many of so much weight that they often defend the above-mentioned authors by affirming they have affected such an obscurity in their style and manner of writing that though every one may read their works, there will be but very few who can comprehend their meaning. The Spectator, number 379, 1712. En cherchant toujours l'énergie et le sublime, il devient outré et se perd dans les mots. Gracian est au bon moraliste ce que Don Quichotte est au vrai héros. Ils ont l'un et l'autre un faux air de grandeur qui en impose aux sots et qui fait rire les sages. Abbé des Fontaines, 1745. Que de elogios no se deben al autor del Criticon. En medio de las antitesis, paranomasias y toda la metralla culta, es una de las obras más recomendables de nuestra literatura por la felicidad de la invención, la inagotable riqueza de imaginación y de sales, por la viveza de sus pinturas y por la gracia, soltura y naturalidad del estilo. Don Manuel Silvela, Biblioteca Selecta de Literatura Española, 1819. Si hubiese Gracián procedido con más sobriedad en el uso de estos juegos y conceptos, ¿cuál es el escritor de su tiempo, de tantos dotes y caudal nativo para ser el más fecundo y elegante, sabiendo, como lo manifesto, en dónde estaban las delicatezas y los donaires, esto es, lo amargo, lo dulce, lo picante, lo salado de la lengua castellana? Don Antonio Cammani, Teatro de la Elocuencia Española, tomo 5. The Oraculo Manual has been more used than any other of the author's works. It is intended to be a collection of maxims of general utility, but it exhibits good and bad precepts, sound judgments, and refined sophisms, all confounded together. In this work, Gracian has not forgotten to inculcate his practical principles of Jesuitism to be all things to all men. Hacerse a todos. Not to recommend his favorite maxim, to be common in nothing, en nada vulgar, which, in order to be valid, would require a totally different interpretation from that which he has given it. Bauterwick. The person, however, who settled the character of cultismo and in some respects gave it an air of philosophical pretension was Baltasar Gracian, a Jesuit of Aragon, who lived between 1601 and 1658, exactly the period when the cultivated style took possession of Spanish prose and rose to its greatest consideration. G. Ticknor, History of Spanish Literature, 3, 222. Dabei ist es das einzige seiner Art und nie ein anderes über denselben Gegenstand geschrieben worden. Denn nur ein Individuum aus der feinsten aller Nationen, der Spanischen, konnte es versuchen. Dasselbe lehrt die Kunst, derer alle sich befließigen, und ist daher für jedermann. Besonders aber ist es geeignet, das Handbuch aller derer zu werden, die in der großen Welt leben, ganz vorzüglich aber junger Leute, die ihr Glück darin zu machen bemüht sind, und denen es mit einem Mal und zum Voraus die Belehrung gibt, die sie sonst erst durch lange Erfahrung erhalten. A. Schopenhauer, Literarische Notiz vor seiner Übersetzung, 1831, published 1861. Avec beaucoup d'esprit, d'instruction et de facilité, il n'a rien produit qui puisse aujourd'hui soutenir l'examen de la critique la plus impartiale. Puis Busque, Histoire comparée des littératures espagnoles et françaises, 1843, 1, page 559. Gracian aurait pu être un excellent écrivain s'il n'avait pas voulu devenir un écrivain extraordinaire. Doué d'une vaste érudition, d'un esprit fin, d'un talent profond d'observation, il était né pour éclairer son siècle. mais la vanité de devenir novateur corrompit son goût en le portant à introduire dans la prose ce langage précieux, ces expressions alambiquées que Gongora avait introduites dans les vers. A. de Baca, Bibliothèque des écrivains de la Compagnie de Jésus, 1869. S. V. Gracián. Así como las máximas de Antonio Pérez fueron muy populares entre cortesanos o doctos o ilustrados, así españoles como extranjeros, porque la delicadeza especial de estilo, las del padre Baltasar Gracián, alcanzaron la misma estima por ese atildamiento en el decir, atildamiento que tenía en sí un inexplicable atractivo, y que aunque algo participaba del general culteranismo de la literatura española en aquel siglo, encerraba cierto buen gusto, deslumbrador y lisonjero para el lector que sus profundísimos conceptos preciaba con la fuerza de su ingenio aquelos. Don Adolfo de Castro, Obras escogidas de filosofía, 1873, page 108. Taking the book as a guide, especially for those who intend to enter public life, I have never chanced to meet with anything which seemed to me even distantly to approach it. It would possibly be rather difficult to disprove the thesis that the Spanish nation has produced the best maxims of practical wisdom, the best proverb, the best epitaph, and the best motto in the world. If I had to sustain it, I would point with reference to the first head to the Oraculo Manuel. Sir M. E. Grant Duff on Baltasar Gracián in Fortnightly Review, March 1877. Some have found light in the sayings of Baltasar Gracián, a Spaniard who flourished at the end of the 17th century. I do not myself find Gracián much of a companion, though some of his aphorisms give a neat turn to a commonplace. J. Morley on Aphorisms, Studies, 1891, page 86. End of section 1.
Section 2 of The Art of Worldly Wisdom by Baltasar Gracián, translated by Joseph Jacobs. Introduction. 1. Of Baltasar Gracián and his works. We may certainly say of Gracián what Heine, by an amiable fiction, said of himself. He was one of the first men of his century. For he was born on the 8th of January, 1601, N.S. at Belmont, a suburb of Calatayud, in the Kingdom of Aragon. Calatayud, properly Calat Ayub, Job's town, is nearly on the site of the ancient Bilbilis, Martial's birthplace. As its name indicates, it was one of the Moorish settlements, and nearly one of the most northern. By Gracián's time, it had again been Christian and Spanish for many generations, and Gracián himself was of noble birth. For a Spaniard of noble birth, only two careers were open, arms and the church. In the 17th century, arms had yielded to the cassock, and Balthasar and his three brothers all took orders. Felipe, his eldest, joined the order of St. Francis. The next brother, Pedro, became a Trinitarian during his short life, and a third, Raimundo, became a Carmelite. Balthasar himself tells us, Agudeza, chapter 25, that he was brought up in the house of his uncle, the licentiate Antonio Gracián, at Toledo, from which we may gather that both his father and his mother, Morales, died in his early youth. He joined the Company of Jesus in 1619, when in its most flourishing state, after the organizing genius of Aquaviva had given solid form to the bold counterstroke of Loyola to the Protestant Revolution. The Ratio Studiorum was just coming into full force, and Gracián was one of the earliest men in Europe to be educated on the system which has dominated the secondary education of Europe almost down to our own days. This point is of some importance, we shall see, in considering Gracián's chief work. Once enrolled among the ranks of the Jesuits, the individual disappears, the Jesuit alone remains. There is scarcely anything to record of Gracián's life, except that he was a Jesuit and engaged in teaching what passes with the order for philosophy and sacred literature, and became ultimately rector of the Jesuit college at Tarragona. His great friend was Don Vincenzo Juan de Lastanosa, a dilettante of the period, who lived at Huesca and collected coins, medals, and other archaeological bric-a-brac. Gracián appears to have shared his tastes, for Lastanosa mentions him in his description of his own cabinet. A long correspondence with him was once extant and seen by La Tassa, who gives the dates and places where the letters were written. From these it would seem that Gracián moved about considerably from Madrid to Saragossa and thence to Tarragona. From another source we learn that Philip III often had him to dinner to provide Attic salt to the royal table. He preached, and his sermons were popular. In short, a life of prudent prosperity came to an end when Baltasar Gracián, rector of the Jesuit college at Tarragona, died there on the 6th of December 1658, at the age of nearly 58 years. Of Gracián's works there is perhaps more to say, even while leaving for separate consideration that one which is here presented to the English reader and forms his chief claim to attention. Spanish literature was passing into its period of swagger, a period that came to all literatures of modern Europe after the training in classics had given a fresh descent of style. The characteristic of this period in a literature is suitably enough the appearance of conceits, or elaborate and far-fetched figures of speech. The process began with Antonio Guevara, author of El Libro Aureo, from which, according to some, the English form of the disease, known as euphuism, was derived. But it received a further impetus from the success of the stilo culto of Gongora in poetry. Gongorism drove conceit to its farthest point. Artificiality of diction could go no farther in verse. It was only left for Gracián to apply it to prose. He did this for the first time in 1630 in his first work, El Héroe. This was published, like most of his other works, by his lifelong friend Lastanosa, and under the name of Lorenzo Gracián, a supposititious brother of Gracián's, who, so far as can be ascertained, never existed. The whole of El Héroe exists, in shortened form, in the Oraculo Manual. The form, however, is so shortened that it would be difficult to recognize the original primores, as they are called, of El Héroe. Yet it is precisely in the curtness of the sentences that the peculiarity of the stilo culto consists. Generally elaborate metaphor and far-fetched allusions go with long and involved sentences of the periodic type. But with Gracián, the aim is as much towards shortness as towards elaboration. The embroidery is rich, but the jacket is short, as he himself might have said. As for the subject matter, the extracts in the Oraculo will suffice to give some notion of the lofty ideal or character presented in El Héroe. The ideal indeed associated in the popular mind with the term Hidalgo. A later book, El Discreto, first published in 1647, gives the counterpoise to El Héroe by drawing an ideal of the prudent courtier as contrasted with the proud and spotless Hidalgo. This too is fully represented in the book before us, but the curtailment is still more marked than in the case of El Héroe. There is evidence that Gracián wrote a similar pair of contrasts, termed respectively El Galante and El Varón Atento, which were not published but were incorporated in the Oraculo Manual by Lastanosa. The consequences of this utilization of contrasts will concern us later. Reverting to Gracián's works somewhat more in their order, his Éloge of Ferdinand, the Magus of Columbus's epoch, need not much detain us. It is stilted and conventional, and does not betray much historical insight. Gracián's Agudeza y Arte de Ingenio is of more importance and interest as the formal exposition of the critical principles of cultismo. It is concerned more with verse than prose, and represents the poetics of Gongorism. A curious collection of flowers of rhetoric in Spanish verse could be made from it. Of still more restricted interest is the Comulgador, or Sacred Meditations, for Holy Communion. I do not profess to be a judge of this class of literature, if literature it can be called, but the fact that the book was deemed worthy of an English translation as lately as 1676 seems to show that it still answers the devotional needs of the Catholics. It has a personal interest for Gracián, as it was the only book of his that appeared under his own name. There remains only to be considered, besides the Oraculum Manual, Gracián's El Criticon, a work of considerable value and at least historic interest, which appeared in the three parts dealing with youth, maturity, and old age, respectively, during the years 1650 to 53. This is a kind of philosophic romance or allegory depicting the education of the human soul. A Spaniard named Critilo is wrecked on St. Helena, and there finds a sort of man Friday, whom he calls Andrenio. Andrenio, after learning to communicate with Critilo, gives him a highly elaborate autobiography of his soul from the age of 3 days or so. They then travel to Spain, where they meet truth, valor, falsehood, and other allegorical females and males, who are labelled by Critilo, for Andrenio's benefit, in the approved and frigid style of the allegorical teacher. Incidentally, however, the ideals and aspirations of the Spaniard of the 17th century are brought out, and from this point of view, the book derives the parallel with the Pilgrim's Progress, which Ticknor had made for it. It is certainly one of the most characteristic products of Spanish literature, both for style and subject matter. Nearly all these works of Gracián were translated into most of the cultured languages of Europe, English not excepted. Part of this ecumenical fame was doubtless due to the fact that Gracián was a Jesuit, and brethren of his order translated the works of one of whom the order was justly proud. But this explanation cannot altogether account for the wide spread of Gracián's works, and there remains a deposit of genuine ability and literary skill involved in most of the works I have briefly referred to, ability and skill of an entirely obsolete kind nowadays, but holding a rank of their own in the 17th and 18th centuries, when didacticism was all the rage. It is noteworthy that the testimonia I have collected for the most part pass over the Oraculo, the only work at which a modern would care to cast a second glance, and go into raptures over El Criticon and its fellows, or the reverse of raptures on Gracián's style, which after all was the most striking thing about his works. That style reaches its greatest perfection in the Oraculo Manual, to which we might at once turn, but for a preliminary inquiry which it seems worthwhile to make. It is a book of maxims, as distinguished from a book of aphorisms, and it is worthwhile for several reasons inquiring into maxims in general, and maxim literature in particular, before dealing with what is probably the most remarkable specimen of its class. Before, however, doing this, we may close this section of our introductory remarks by putting in, as the lawyers say, the Latin inscription given by La Tassa from the foot of the portrait of Gracián, which once stood in the Jesuit college at Calatayud, a portrait of which, alas, no trace can now be found. The lines sum up in sufficiently forcible Latin all that need be known of Baltasar Gracián and his works. P. Baltasar Gracián, ut jam ab ortu emineret, in Bellomonte natus est, prope bilbilim, confinis martialis patria proximus ingenio, ut profunderet ad hoc Christianas argutias bilbilis, quae poeni exhaustam videbatur in ethnicis. Ergo augens natale ingenium innato acumine scripsit. Artem ingenii et arte facit scibile, quod scibiles facit artes. Scripsit item artem prudentiae et asse ipso artem didicit. Scripsit oraculum et voces sues protulit. Scripsit desertum ut se ipsum describeret, et ut scriberet eroem eroica patravit. Hec et alia eis scripta moecenates reges habuerunt, judices admirationem lectorem mundum, typographum eternitatem, Philippus tres sepe ilius argutias. Inter prandium versabat ne deficerent sales regiis dapibus. Sed cui plausus excitaverat calamo deditus missionibus, excitavit planctus verbo, excitaturus desiderium in morte qua raptus fuit. Sex decembris, anno 1658. Sed aliquando extintus aeternum lucebit. 2. Of maxims. Many men have sought to give their views about man and about life in a pithy way. A few have tried to advise man in short sentences what to do in the various emergencies of life. The former have written aphorisms, the latter maxims. Where the aphorism states a fact of human nature, a maxim advises a certain course of action. The aphorism is written in the indicative, the maxim in an imperative mood. Life is interesting, if not happy, is an aphorism of Professor Seeley's, I believe. Ascend a step to choose a friend, descend a step to choose a wife, is a maxim of Rabbi Meir, one of the doctors of the Talmud. Now it is indeed curious how few maxims have ever been written. Wisdom has been extolled on the housetops, but her practical advice seems to have been kept secret. Taking our own literature, there are extremely few books of practical maxims, and not a single one of any great merit. Sir Walter Raleigh's Cabinet Council, Penn's Maxims, and Chesterfield's Letters almost exhaust the list, and the last generally contains much more than mere maxims. Nor are they scattered with any profusion through books teeming with knowledge of life, the galaxy of English novels. During recent years, extracts of their Beauties have been published in some profusion, Wit and Wisdom of Beaconsfield, Wise, Witty and Tender Sayings of George Eliot, extracts from Thackeray and the rest, but the crop of practical maxims to be found among them is extremely scanty. Aphorisms there are in plenty, especially in George Eliot, but he that is doubtful what course to pursue in any weighty crisis would woefully waste his time if he sought for advice from the novelists. Nor are the moralists more instructive in this regard. Bacon's essays leave with one the impression of fullness of practical wisdom, yet closely examined, there is very little residue of practical advice left in his pregnant sayings. Even the source of most of this kind of writing, the Biblical Book of Proverbs, fails to answer the particular kind of test I am at present applying. However shrewd some of them are, startling us with the consciousness how little human nature has changed, it is knowledge of human nature that they mainly supply. When we ask for instruction how to apply that knowledge, we only get variations of the theme, fear the Lord. 2,000 years of experience have indeed shown that the fear or love of the Lord forms a very good foundation for practical wisdom, but it has to be supplemented by some such corollary as keep your powder dry before it becomes of direct service in the conduct of life. It is indeed because of the unpractical nature of practical maxims that they have been so much neglected. You must act in the concrete, you can only maximize in general terms. Then again, maxims can only appeal to the mind, to the intellect. The motive force of action is the will, the temperament. As Disraeli put it, the conduct of men depends on the temperament, not upon a bunch of musty maxims. Henrietta Temple. It is only very distantly that a maxim can stir the vague desire that spurs an imitative will. True, at times we read of men whose whole life has been coloured by a single saying, but these have generally been more appeals to the imagination, like Newman's Securus judicat orbis terrarum, or the Heu, fuge crudelas terras, fuge litus avarum, which had so decisive an effect on Savonarola's life. It is rare indeed that a man's whole life is tinged by a single practical maxim, like Sir Daniel Gooch, who was influenced by his father's advice, stick to one thing. Perhaps one of the reasons that have led literary persons to neglect the maxim as a literary form has been their own ignorance of action, and still more, their exaggerated notions of its difficulties and complexities. Affairs are not conducted by aphorisms. War is waged by a different kind of maxims from those we are considering. Yet, after all, there must be some general principles on which actions should be conducted, and one would think they could be determined. Probably the successful men of action are not sufficiently self-observant to know exactly on what their success depends, and if they did, they would in most cases try to keep it in the family, like their wealth or their trade secrets. And perhaps, after all, they are right who declare that action has little to do with intellect and much with character. To say the truth, one is not impressed with the intellectual powers of the millionaires one meets. The shadiest of journalists could often explain their own doings with more point than they. Yet there are surely intellectual qualifications required for affairs. The Suez Canal must have required as great an amount of research, emendation, sense of order and organization as, say, the Corpus Inscriptionum Latinarum. But there is no such punishment for slovenly scholarship in action as there is in letters. The Suez Canal can be dug only once. Lucretius or Latin inscriptions can be edited over and over again. Altogether, we need not be surprised if the men of action cannot put the principles of action into pointed sentences or maxims. And if men of action cannot, it is not surprising that men of letters do not, for they cannot have the interest in action and its rewards which is required for worldly success, or else they would not be able to concentrate their thoughts on things which they consider of higher import. To a man of letters, the world is the devil, or ought to be, if he is to have the touch of idealism which gives colour and weight to his words. How then is he to devote his attention to worldly wisdom and the maxims that are to teach it? It is characteristic in this connection that the weightiest writer of maxims in our language is Bacon, who attempted to combine a career of affairs and of thought, and spoilt both by so doing. It is perhaps due to the subtle and all-embracing influence of Christianity on modern civilization that this divorce between idealism and the world has come about. The strenuous opposition to the world, among earnest Christians, has led to their practical withdrawal from it. Just as the celibacy of the clergy meant that the next generation was to be deprived of the hereditary influence of some of the purest spirits of the time, so the opposition of Christianity to the world has brought it about that the world has been unchristian. Only one serious attempt has been made to bridge the chasm. The idée mère of Jesuitism was to make the world Christian, by Christians becoming worldly. It was doubtless due to the reaction against the over-spiritualization of Christianity, pressed by the Protestant Reformation, but its practical result has been to make the Jesuit a worldly Christian. The control of the higher education of Europe by the Jesuits had tended, on the other hand, to make society more Christian. If then we were to look for an adequate presentation of worldly wisdom, touched with sufficient idealism to make it worthy of a man of letters, we should look for it from a Jesuit, or from one trained among the Jesuits. After all this elaborate explanation why so few maxims have been composed, it may seem contradictory to give as a further and final reason, because so many exist, under another form. For what are the majority of proverbs but maxims under another name, or rather, maxims without a name of their author? We say of proverbs, indeed, that they arise among the people, but it is one definite individual among the people that gives them the piquant form that makes them proverbial. It was, we may be sure, a definite English gaffer who first said, "Penny wise, pound foolish." If we knew his name, we should call it a maxim. As his name is unknown, it ranks as a proverb. In this connection, the Talmudic proverbs and maxims are of great interest. Owing to the worthy rabbinic principle, "Say a thing in the name of the man who said it," we can in almost all cases trace Talmudic proverbs to their authors, or in other words, Talmudic proverbs remain maxims. There is only one analogous case in English. A few of Benjamin Franklin's maxims, e.g., "Three removes are as good as a fire," have become proverbs. The abundance of proverbs is extraordinary. There is a whole bibliography devoted to the literature of proverbs. Duplessis, Bibliographie Paremiologique, Paris, 1847. And this needs nowadays a supplement as large again as the original, partly supplied by the bibliographical appendix of Heller, Altspanische Sprichwörter.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.